everyone, I'm Sherry from QuantConnect. In this lesson, we're going to use a buy and hold algorithm to introduce you to using futures in QuantConnect. We'll sort and filter futures contracts by open interest, calculate position size, place orders, and manage for margin calls. All right, let's dive in. So in this first task, we'll request futures data and filter which futures contracts we receive by their expiration date. Futures contracts are standardized agreements to buy or sell an asset at a time in the future. This time is called the expiry date, and it's the last date the contract can be traded. To work with futures contracts, we start by requesting futures data for an asset with the addFuture method, which we see an example of here. Each asset has an associated product code, like an equities ticker. For example, gold's product code is GC, and silver's product code is SI. The good thing is you don't need to remember any of the codes. You can access them through QC's static helper classes in this reference table. And in the reference table, you'll see the assets fall into 9 general categories, like grains, currencies, and energies. When you request futures contracts, you can set the resolution of the data to tick, second, or minute. So let's go ahead and request gold contracts now. Since the question doesn't specify a resolution, we'll get minute data resolution by default. So each asset has many contracts, each with different expiry dates. We'll use setFilter to receive contracts with a specific expiration date range. The default filter returns contracts that expire within the next 35 days. So now, based on the problem that we see here, let's return contracts expiring within 90 days. All right, and we can submit our solution and see how we did. Cool. Okay, we passed this task. Let's continue on. Now let's access a contract from a futures contract chain. The data we requested comes in slices in the OnData event handler. Each slice contains a list of contracts for that futures product, called a chain. If we subscribe to one asset, gold, we receive one chain with all of the filtered contracts we requested. If we subscribe to more assets, for example, gold and silver, they'll each have a contract chain in the future chains dictionary. So we can see an exploration of the futures contract chain here and accessing the value property here. So there are many properties available for each contract, such as expiry, price, volume, and open interest. In this task, we want to filter by one of these properties, open interest. Open interest counts the number of positions open at the end of each trading day. So taking a look at our objectives, let's first filter for popular contracts with an open interest greater than 1,000, and we can use list comprehension to do that. Our filtered list might not have any contracts with open interests greater than 1,000 positions. In that case, our self.popular contracts list length would be 0. So for our next question, let's write an if statement. If the length of our popular contracts is 0, let's continue on. Now, if we do have contracts with an open interest greater than 1,000, then let's sort these contracts in descending order. We can use the sorted function to do that. Because we sorted in descending order, the first contract in our sorted list will have the highest open interest. We can save that contract to self.liquidContract. All right, let's submit and see how we did. Okay, super. Now let's move on to the next task. All right, now let's calculate the notional value of a contract and the number of contracts we could purchase. So far, we've subscribed to gold contracts, filtered for contracts that expire within the next 90 days, and saved the liquid contract, which is the contract with the highest open interest in that slice. Now let's open positions on that contract. So each futures contract represents a standardized number of units. For example, a single gold futures contract purchases 100 troy ounces of gold. Each asset has a standard contract size. You can access the asset's contract size in QC with the contract multiplier property, which is located on the symbols property. We can see that here. Because the gold futures contract controls 100 ounces of gold, its true value is more than its listed price, which is for 1 ounce of gold. The true total value can be calculated by the futures contract price multiplied by the standard contract size, and this is called the notional value. For example, when we're multiplying the price for 1 ounce of gold, say it's $600, by our contract multiplier of 100 troy ounces, we'll get a notional value of $60,000. And we can see that example here. All right, let's calculate our notional value for our liquid contract. Each futures contract has its own security object. The rest of the objectives in this lesson are going to help us calculate the position size. So let's first save our future contract security object to make it easier to use later on. Okay, so depending on the futures product volatility, the exchanges assign a required initial margin. This is a deposit paid upfront for the contract. It's roughly 3% of the notional value of the contract, and we can access this initial margin on the futures margin model. As we buy contracts, these payments are deducted from our buying power. Buying power, or margin, is our purchasing power available for trading. We access it through the algorithm portfolio helper self.portfolio.marginRemaining. Now let's calculate a position size which uses all of our available margin. To do that, we can divide portfolio margin remaining by the contract initial margin, and it may help to save remaining margin and initial margin to their own variables. And now to access the initial margin, we're going to want to use that contract security object that we saved earlier. And our problem asks us to use the floor function to return the closest integer value. So let's use that when we calculate our contracts to buy. Okay, great. Now, to place a market order for the contract, we'll use the contract symbol and the position size, which we just saved to self.contracts to buy. All right, that was a lot. Let's see how we did. Okay, really cool. We completed that task. We'll take a look at our console real quick too and see that we got a margin call warning. So let's explore what that means next. Okay, in the final task, we'll swap out the manual calculations we just wrote to use set holdings to automatically calculate position size and eliminate the margin call by assigning a wider portfolio cash buffer. We get a margin call when our margin remaining is less than brokerage requirements. When this happens, the brokerage will sell off part of the portfolio. In QuantConnect, if this is about to occur, we alert you with a margin call warning, like we saw in the previous task. To reduce this risk, we can create a buffer of cash using a free portfolio percentage. This is controlled by the self.settings.freePortfolioValuePercentage. This will result in purchasing fewer contracts as it will leave more cash in your account. Let's set our free portfolio percentage to 30%. And we can take what was in the example. For futures, set holdings can be used to automatically calculate the number of contracts to purchase. Unlike other asset classes, the target percentage must be in the range of 1 to negative 1. Using 1 represents allocating 100% of our buying power to the contract. And behind the scenes, set holdings is reducing the buying power by the free portfolio cash buffer percentage and assigning what is left to the contract. Our next objective asks us to remove the existing trading logic to make room for set holdings. Let's do that now. Finally, let's set our holdings to 100% of our buying power for a self.liquid contract. Okay, let's submit the task and see how we did. Okay, yes, congratulations. You've just passed the Buy and Hold Futures Bootcamp. Thanks so much for joining me on this tutorial, and I can't wait to see you next time.